particularly natural and the lack of life is strong. We have plenty of opportunities to enjoy the city, so thank you for coming. Amazing to visit this site in which you are discussing. And in this session, we have four talks. Okay, so we will have some kind of flexibility on terms of time, because the sessions are scheduled for five talks. We have actually two before, so we have some flexibility for some extra 20 minutes. That means that if you can begin talking 20 minutes, and we have spent 3 minutes for questions for each presentation, but please try not to expand more than that, okay, notes, so that you don't eat extra time from all of them. Best recognition.
Okay, so the application that we are trying to apply here is identifying emotion and classify learner involvement in an interest in topic. So we want to look at what are the facial expression when students study some topic. So based on your facial expression, we will detect whether you have interest or no interest at all. But at the moment we have a problem with that because of the light and also for the facial posture and also because of lack of data for brain. So to investigate the performance of the proposed technique, we use the dataset namely called the JAFFE, which is the Japanese, and also the CK plus. So we use these two because one is Asian faces and CK is European faces. So we want to look at the performance of the proposed technique using two different datasets. So these are the three main issues that are affecting the performance of any algorithm in classifying emotion: image illumination, the lighting, image quality, and also partial feature recognition. For example, you have a spec or you are facing the other side or the other side. So we want to address this problem by proposing the hybrid between the what we call it deep active appearance model and also the deep neural network. So the motivation behind this is that we want to enrich the features that we capture from the face. So by applying the proposed technique, we hope to get more details, more clear face of the person. Because what happens is that when we train the deep learning algorithm for a normal face, it works. But when you try to test it using a different person, for example, someone from Nigeria, with black faces, so the model cannot recognize the face because you have different features, black color. So last time we did that when we were in Germany, and we cut the face, we cut the demo, because we train our model using Asian and also European, but we forgot about the Nigerian people. They are black. So based on that problem, we say, okay, what if we can extract the feature regardless of the color? So I want to have the texture, not the structure of the face, and also improve the texture of the face. So only using the DAAM or the deep active appearance model, we could achieve that. So the method that we use for the face detection, we use the Vaillant-Jones algorithm. Okay, so once we capture the detect the face, then we will align the face using the face aligner. The affine transformation is used to rotate, scaling, and translation is used to normalize the face. So this is the effect. And for the feature refinement, so this is the method that we use in order to refine the features. Okay. So they are divided into two. One is looking at the structure of your face, and the other one is looking at the texture of your face. And based on this robust Boltzmann machine, the Gaussian and also binary, we have another level here that will combine these two. So this one will be the appearance model that we have. Okay. So for example, if we have a blur image or not straight, okay, and also we have the side view, and also this one, a spectacle. So by using the DAAM approach, okay, the first row display the original image, and the final product will be this one. So we have a much, much clearer image for classification. The second row, shape three images. So we are looking at the shape. And the third row, facial interpretation using PCA. So this is used to look at the coordinate of your face, like the eye, the distance of your nose and your mouth. And lastly, facial interpretation using that. So this one, we are looking at the structure and also the patch. So only by having this kind of enrichment, feature enrichment, we can improve the classification of facial expression that we have. Okay? And once we have a high quality data, then we could use the CNN, the convolutional neural network. They have three layers, two consecutive convolutional pooling layers, and last one is the what we call it, the fully connected with dropout. So this is used for classification. But in this case also, we want to investigate what are the hyperparameter settings that influence the performance of this CNN. So we are looking at the percentage of dropout. We are looking also the number of epochs and also the size of the testing and also size of the training and also the testing. Okay. So these are the experimental setup that we have. So we are looking at trying to find the best setting, which include number of epochs, percentage of dropout, and also a percentage of validation data set use. And we start with this, and then try to detect the phase, and then phase alignment because of the log spread and horizontal. And then the feature refinement. These images, then we can fit them into the training and also we split them into two because we want to study the effect of using the feature refinement. So we have training both sides, and then we train our model, and then we compare the performance based on accuracy. We also compare the performance that other researchers have conducted previously. So in order to look at the performance of the proposed approach using different hyperparameter, we have decided to use this. The initial value for number of epoch, number of dropout and validation, we get from the overall review what to apply. So we take the mean and max, then we discretize the image. Discretize the value so that we can have a multiple setting here. Okay. So the way we did the experiment is that we have the D stand for dropout. Okay. So the first thing that we did is we set the initial value, dropout, and also the number. The dropout and the validation percentage, then we try all this value, and then once we get the highest value, then we set up particular value to be fixed here, and then this one remain the minimum. Then we try the other value for the dropout, then we get the highest one, then we fix that one here, and then for the validation again we try with some other values. So we did it for both data sets, and then these are the findings that we get. The performance of your face recognition is better when you have higher epoch number, and higher recognition rate can be obtained when the dropout percentage value is lower than 5%. Okay, so when the epoch number is fixed to 100 and the dropout percentage is set to 5%, in JAFFE, we get the best accuracy up to 97.4 when the percentage solution dataset is set to 30%, and for the CK plus we get 96.9. So based on this, we can say that the hyperparameter setting affect the performance of the proposed technique that we have. And when we compare with the existing result or previously published, we use this setting to get the best parameter, to get the best accuracy. And then this is what we propose. And this is without the feature refinement, so which is much lesser accuracy compared to the one that we propose. So this one also turned out to be better than what people have been published in 2011. And also for the JAFFE, we have 97.4% better compared to Zeng and also Bio. So not many people have gone into this area because they mentioned that the accuracy is quite high.
Okay.
But in this paper, we propose the hybrid of this DAAM and also DCNN in order to improve the performance classification. So, okay. So in summary, the hybrid approach that combines the DAAM and also DCNN can be used to effectively improve the features and then used for facial expression recognition. So this can be seen based on the result that we get, that with high quality and also with refined features, we can improve the classification of the face that we have. But the only thing that we need not do is that we need to look at how do we further optimize the same and parameter, like the size of the filter, how many layer that we need, how many hidden layer that we need. So all those things will be an open problem for anyone to solve. But I think some are doing that. So with that, thank you. And welcome any question and suggestion.
Change much, and I'm curious if this really makes makes a difference for the training of CNNs?
Yeah, if you look at row number two, they just capture the shape.
Yeah.
And then row number three, they look at they pick the distance between the eyes, but it is not shown here. So the distance between the eyes, nose, and the mouth. So they construct this one.
So there is a difference, but is it really an important difference for training the network? Does it change how the network performs?
I think the hyperbolic dataset thinking rules more. And what we did is we tried to have a better quality images in order to improve the classification. But little only.
Little?
Yeah, little only. And the worst case is that it takes more time to process.
Thank you.
Any other comment or question? Perhaps I have some comments in the previous question. One of the most important things to remember when we are working with the deep learning models is that those models strongly rely on the training data. So, in this case, for instance, having a diversity in terms of the kind of faces and processes used for training sets can change the results. And that says, the speaker mentioned that the data sets we're using for this score come from European faces and Asian faces. So, it cannot be generalized to all cases.
Yes.
It would require extra training data in order to improve the learning model. And this is typical for all new learning models, because there is only relies on training. I'm training on huge number of data in the model. The second thing I want to stress is that you can ask about human emotions, really tough. Do you think that even people questioning if there are some universal criteria to determine the emotion for everyone? Because it has a strong cultural background. So people, depending on the areas and the culture express emotion in a different way. So people are asking, even today, if there is a universal way to recognize some basic emotions. So it is a very tough work. Also, I remember an interesting work from Professor Hassan Ugarin from the University of Bratislava. He made it some headlines in the newspapers a few years ago. It was about recognizing when some people is lying. And he analyzed also the human emotions and different face features. And the student thing to me was that he discovered that the most important feature to discover when someone is lying is in the eyes. Not in your face or your mouth or whatever, it's in the eyes. There's a subtle difference between the behavior or behavior in the eyes where some people is lying or not.
What one of the eyes?
Yeah, yes, it's that area. So it was shocking to the community at that time. But in the time when we are thinking about emotions, and probably most people focusing on what happens in this part of the muscles around your mouth, it was the other part that is the trick to discover that. So it just showed that this field is not easy at all. So and you are discovering new things every day. And I think this kind of words is very, very important in order for us, even as human beings, to discover what it is for us in terms of emotions. And this is an interesting and exciting research field in the future. I mean, you can find many journals talking about, many companies talking about intelligence and emotional intelligence. So, something that we criticize the artificial intelligence systems lack of in the past. And now we are trying to include that topic into the AI developments. So this is one step of the
And the other comment question? Okay, so thank you very much.